Heroes on the march!
Legendary was the Xanadu where Kublai Khan decreed his stately pleasure dome. Today, almost as legendary is AC 211. Here on the campus of Bethel University, a private library was built, students were mentored, and stories were told, and retold, and retold, by its landlord, Bethel's Kublai Khan, G. William Carlson. In Bethel's history, other names are honored, but few are more justly revered than the simple initials GW. Many know that when the original Bethel opened its doors in Chicago in 1871, there was but one student, Christopher Silene. But who was the second, you ask? That's right, G. William Carlson. The pietistic poetry of his grandma, Signy, ringing in his ears, this plucky rapscallion traded the bustling burgs of New Jersey for the tranquil Bethel Quad. What were the humble denizens of the Middle West to make of this brash Easterner? We asked Bethel's founding president, J.A. Edgren.
So, well, call me Jay. G.W. was, from the beginning, a pietist, you could tell. He was there, rooted and grounded in the pietist tradition.
Full of vim and vigor, G.W. arrived at Bethel, ready to conquer the worlds of mathematics and cross-country running, and to campaign for Republican candidates, national and local. But the best-laid plans often go awry. Before too long, friendly and helpful Bethel professors had convinced young Carlson to take up the study of history. And after the scandalous compromise of 1876 ended Reconstruction, G.W. rejected the GOP. Proclaiming himself no Hayes Republican, he began a lifelong association with the Democratic Party. Finally, G.W. graduated from Bethel College. After teaching high school social studies, he returned to his alma mater as a faculty member. The year was 1968, and with his luxurious facial hair, eclectic neckties, and radical politics, G.W. embodied the spirit of the age. In city or suburb, whatever the Bethel or U.S. president, for over 40 years there was no public issue on which G.W. Carlson took no stand, whether he was running for public office, or ruling over the promotion and tenure committee, where the fates of his colleagues rested in his golf club calloused hands, or publishing his opinions in the mimeographed pages of the Baptist Pietist Clarion, or preaching from the pulpits of courses on Russian history, Christian nonviolence, political ideology or the modern world, or talking for an hour or two to the unsuspecting visitor lured by the spectacle of the AC 211 library. So big, it can never be cataloged or appraised, GW's voice proved impossible to silence or ignore. Or silence. Then this semester, as it must to all professors, retirement came to G. William Carlson.
News! On the mark!
Well, 40 years in a man's career, it's a lot to fit into a newsreel.
It's a good short, Garrett, but what you need is an angle. All I saw on that screen is that G.W. Carlson's retired. I know that. I read blank. You see, Garrett, it's not enough to tell us what a man did. You've got to tell us who he was.
Wait a minute. What were G.W.'s last words? Do you remember? What were the last things he said before leaving? Maybe he told us all about himself.
Yeah, maybe he didn't.
I tell you, Garrett, it's a man's retiring words.
What were they?
When G.W. retired, he said just one word. Framework.
Now here's a man who defined Bethel for four decades, but when he comes to retire, he's got something on his mind called framework. What's that supposed to mean?
Maybe it's just a word he said now and then, and again, and again.
Well, let's ask the question anyway. Geertz, when's the roasted toast?
May 23rd.
Then that's how long you've got. Ask his friends, ask his enemies, ask Frenchie. But I got a hunch. Ask what is framework, and you'll answer who is GW.
Get on it right away.
Good. Framework, dead or alive. It'll probably turn out to be a very simple thing.
Framework?
Framework? Framework? Framework.
Yeah, I think I just ignore that when he does that. You know, the frameworks.
Framework.
Framework.
Framework?
Framework.
Framework?
And I must confess that the golf course is the only place I've never heard him use the word framework.
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 Framework is confusing as GW himself. Utterly confusing.
Framework.
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 Framework. I have no idea what framework means, but here's what I can tell you about GW. I remember having a heart-to-heart with Neil Lettinga from the history department, who used to be in the office right across the hall from GW, where Chris Geertz is now. And I remember saying to Neil, does he really read all of those books? And Neil looked me square in the eye and said, yeah, he does. And he remembers them.
His legacy is his use of the copy machine, the Xerox machine. And I think that in honor of his time at Bethel, we need to plant some trees, like maybe 12 or 24 trees to honor GW for all of the paper that he's used over his 40 years.
The guy has probably killed millions of trees printing off little hand things from the internet that he can then go and post on his Freedom Wall, which of course is not even on his wall, but is actually on Dr. Geertz's wall across the hall. So everybody of course thinks, you know, Geertz is this crazy, you know, liberal revolutionary, but it's of course GW who's got his Freedom Wall.
One of the things that I admired right from the beginning about Bill was his willingness to run for public office and serve on the school board. I thought anybody who was willing to do that must either be close to sainthood or a masochist. But Bill very much took delight in all of those public meetings, and I just admired that so much.
If GW catches you in the hallway, or he wants to have a conversation with you, you have to be prepared, you know, to have not a two-minute conversation or a five-minute conversation, but closer to a 25 to 30-minute conversation. That's a good, I think, you know, round number.
I'm always interested about a guy who can always say, okay, I've got 3 points to make. And at that point, you say, okay, that's 7 points, really, plus a couple footnotes.
Some of the funniest moments is I'm just sitting here interviewing a student or you know, I'm literally mentoring a student, sitting where you are now or whatever. And GW would come by, or I'm advising them, and GW would come by and say, hey, to the student, not to me. Hey, is this guy causing trouble? Or something like that.
On my schedule, our golfing dates are always off-campus counseling session. Bill has self-image problems when he plays golf, and will often hit a ball badly and then blame it on himself rather than the equipment or anything else. And at those moments, my job is to help him with his mental health at that point.
Everyone knows that when you come to see GW, he doesn't just say, hello, Amy, or, you know, hello, Dr. Holmes, or hello, you know, whoever. He always greets you with one greeting that makes you feel like you're the most important person in the world, but it's sort of always partially your persona, partially your stage of life, and then he always kind of ends it with a question. So I mean, for example, like with me, he always says something. He talks about how we both were A-minus students, so he always says, there's the straight A-minus student who's mother of two, wife of a soccer playing god, something like that.
One of my favorite things about GW personally is when he asks me in the middle of the day, are you going home to watch your kids play soccer? And, GW asking me, are you going home to watch your kids play soccer, was really a gift. What that said was, make sure you're paying attention to the things that are really important. And we all know that GW loves this place, and he's committed enormous amounts of time to this place. But he also knows that there are a lot of things that will take our time and attention here. And there are other things that matter profoundly. And so his direction to go watch my kids play soccer was a good reminder to me that how we live our lives together needs to be balanced, needs to pay attention to our faith and our families and the work that God calls us to do. So I delight in remembering GW's imperative about watching my kids play soccer.
Involuntary journey to Siberia. Russian drinking. Use and abuse of alcohol in pre-revolutionary Russia. What do you think all of this is worth?
Dozens of dollars, if anybody wants it.
So, did you finish talking to the people who knew him? What did they say?
Well, it's become a very clear picture. He is the most honest man who's ever lived. He is tolerant, especially of those who disagreed with him. And he has a gift for friendship such as few people have ever had. Other than that?
But what about framework? Did anyone know what that meant?
No, and I don't think it explains anything. I don't think a word can explain a man's life. No, framework is just a piece in a jigsaw puzzle. A missing piece.
Well, look who we have here. Is this our fine young president who, though he rejected being a royal to be a thunder, can you explain to me how you can be a thunder? How do you cheer for thunder? Has chosen to lead our flock into the treacherous and unknown future of higher ed? Hail to the chief. Well, look who came down here to grace the doorstep of the AC's second floor. To what do I owe this visit from the fine young, distinguished university professor, fisher of both men and fish? Have you come to translate my memoirs into Greek? Here comes the fine, young, twinkly-eyed professor from the lofty third floor of the AC, where we all know the real scholars reside, still using your aw shucks framework of homespun charm and a southern accent to help students navigate the world of Blumhard, Bonhoeffer, and Barth? Well, here he is. Here is the fine, young scholar with his erudite physique and his Calvinist-ordained work ethic. Still coming in at 6:55 every morning, huh? Trying to make the rest of us look bad. Can you reform us? Is there hope for us BGC minions? Ho ho! Oh, here he is. Here's the fine young blurry-eyed scholar, father of a brand new wee little Buckeye, still teaching about terrorism, still trying to use your quick wit and waggish temperament to indoctrinate our students with the belief that they will be better off if they know about world events and current affairs. Well, haha, here he is. Here is our distinguished toga-clad feudal lord of the CWC fiefdom, holder of all knowledge regarding, well, just about everything since time began. Here comes the fine, young, teensy-tiny, census-taking dynamo, Bethel's own, great defender and preserver of the BGC legacy from those that threaten it. Are you still vexing students with the notion that old things matter? Ha! That the past has significance? Here she is. Here's the fine young scholar who bicycled her way from the halls of Calvin to USC, that mecca of the liberal scholarly elite. Still preaching truth? Still trying to convince these kids being a history major will make them a better writer? Showing them how the West was won? Hello! Here comes the fine young scholar, jack of all trades, pen in one hand, chisel, or jackhammer, or whatever building tool in the other. Still trying to persuade our fragile youth that there's life below the 30th parallel? What do you mean there's something else? What do you mean there's somewhere else? Ho ho, en garde! Here's my well-coiffed, bow-tied adversary. Where are your Burkean stocks? Are you still purveying the Western humanities whilst surveying Eastern humanity? Well, hello. Here's our local luminary, the aim of my Friday night channel surfing. Here comes the fine young head shrinker. You had to do it, didn't you? You couldn't keep your talent a secret. You made a deal with the dark side. Still keeping him in line up there? Reminding him what it's like down here in the trenches? And here is our fine young chair with his lanky frame and pietistic persona. Still planning to do your podcasty thing all over Europe in J-term with a twin on each hip? Well, hello! How's the former pride of the department turned campus-renowned colleague? Still trying to impress the tender masses with your fancy iPod-toting, camera-wielding, technologically charged framework?
But mostly, I think GW, I will always remember him as a guy with a fantastic sense of humor, who not only was a great friend and has been a great friend, but was a good father figure to me when he needed to be and when I needed it. So,
I've appreciated about him his love of books. How can you not? You know, when you walk into his office, all of those books. But he has gifted books to my children over the years. He gifts books to people just randomly to, you know, whatever. So I love his love of reading and that he's always reading something. He's always asking you what you're reading. And it's not just history books, but just other things that he's interested in. So I love that about him.
Another thing GW has really provided for me is an introduction to some of the worst restaurants in the city of St. Paul. It's all born of this great impulse to buy local and to support businesses in the community, and I have tried to model that and mirror that in our lives and involvement. We are in the suburbs by half a block, a fact about which he has never failed to remind me. But I have to say that GW's taste in local eateries leaves something to be desired. Bill, we'll try to keep buying local, but we're not going back to Princess Garden.
And of course, don't even get him started about the drinking thing, because, you know, that's another... Oh, yeah. That's probably why he's retiring.
Thank you, GW, for taking me under your arm when I first came. God bless you in your retirement.
And what'll you do now, my blue-eyed son? And what'll you do?
When I think about your time at Bethel, you've served on every important committee we've had. You've led important initiatives. Your fingerprints are all over this place, and that will be your gift to us as you retire. That we'll think about you as we think about policies that have been developed that are help us do things better. We'll think about you when we reflect on what it means to be a pietist institution, and for me, the commitment that you've had to reminding us both about the importance of pietism in our past, but then helping us to think about why that matters so deeply for our future, will be, for me, the thing that will continuously remind me of your time here, your love for Bethel, your love for students. That you've helped many of us really understand what pietism is, why it has mattered to us historically, how it's shaped who we've become, and now as you retire, it will continue to shape who we will be into the future.
thank you, Bill, from the bottom of my heart. I'm grateful, and you will be missed.